together. That's great. Let's stand together as we begin our worship with some songs of the Lord. Look for 4,000 tongues to sing.
Of my God, in Thee, the joy of salvation. it as an odd thing for us to think that we exalt you in one sense that's so very wrong, because you are exalted. Whether we realize it or not, you are exalted. Those who ignore you don't change the fact that you are exalted. Those who claim you don't exist do not change the reality that you are exalted. So on one hand, it seems a little ludicrous for us to say that we exalt you, but that's what you've told us to do. That we are ones who are to proclaim your name, we are ones who are to lift you up, we are ones who are to recognize and point others to the fact and the reality of who you are, that you are God and that you are. And Father, that this world that's going on is here for a reason, for a cause, and the world exalts you, the creation exalts you. We see that, and it's reminded of what Jesus said, that if men know, they'll say anything, the stones will cry out. Father, thank you that you allow us to have a relationship with you, a relationship that really adds nothing to you but everything to us. We are the huge benefactors of a relationship with you. We are the ones who are forgiven. We are the ones who are cleansed. We are the ones who are justified, declared not guilty by you, Father, not because of our sinlessness, but because of the sinlessness of Christ, who died on the cross for our forgiveness, for our sins, that we might be, able to stand before you in holiness and righteousness that is given to us as a gift when we come to you in faith through Christ Jesus our Lord. As we're gathered together here, we are reminded that some are unable to be with us. Lord, some are facing some very serious struggles and some very serious issues health-wise, and some, Father, others, it's just been an emotional roller coaster. This situation in our country right now certainly doesn't help that. But others have so many things going on in their life and pressing on them. We want to lift them before you. We ask that you would go into this week. It's a week in which we will be voting for president. We all have our thoughts. We all have our opinions. We all have those people we would like to see. But Lord, I ask that you would put the man you know we need in place. In one sense, that's a little frightening, because as I read the history of Israel and see that sometimes what they needed certainly wasn't what they wanted. Father, we pray that you would not only guide the election, but I think of our leaders, that you would surround them with godly counsel, that you would help all of them to come to know you as Savior and Lord. And when they get in a position of power, it's very difficult for them sometimes to acknowledge you. It shouldn't be, but it is, Lord. We've seen that in the past. We've seen that in the scriptures. We're going to see that a little bit this morning as we look into your word again. I pray you help us never to be so foolish. Help us never to think that it's us. Never to think that it's our own power, wisdom, or might, our own great ideas. Where we may have put our own ideas before you, we ask that you would help us to put those aside and follow you. There is no great idea without you, Father. There is no true success without you. Thank you for this time to be able to be together. Thank you for the reminders of the fact that you are God, that you are exalted. Thank you for the reality, again, that you are a Lord who is, that we are part of that thousands upon thousands of tongues that sing our great Redeemer's praise. Teach us from your word. Use this time together to refine us more and to help us learn a little bit more what it means to exalt you. To you, indeed, be glory and honor, we pray, in Christ's name. Well, we're glad you're here. Grab your bulletin for just a second. Let me point out a couple of things for you. You see, we're going to be doing the flu shots. If you are wanting a flu shot, sign up in the lobby, because it helps us to know, to be able to tell the pharmacist how many people that kind of expect. So if you're thinking of planning on getting a flu shot, please make sure you sign up. Acorn Bank breaking. All right, some of you don't know what an Acorn Bank is. This is an Acorn Bank. It's a little plastic thing, you throw change in it. Well, you can throw dollar bills in it. Well, you can throw a really big check in there. Just a thought. Anyway, the kids are going to be breaking these on the 15th. That's 2 weeks. Now, you know, these aren't just for the kids, as you know. If you want to bring your bank in next week, that would be a good idea. If you're not able to be here, and even if you think you will be here, they are going to do it in the hour before church. So, you know, get those in and get those here. You know, some of the people watching online, a good reminder for them to be able to get those here this week somehow. So if you don't remember to bring it next Sunday, you can call and drop it off during the week too. That'll be just fine. Operation Christmas Child envelopes are in. As you walk out, if you keep walking straight, you'll walk right into them. You know, I wouldn't advise to do that. The table can be kind of rough on the shins, but it is your option. Okay, so there's Barb's new address for you. If you send her a card, her new address is at the bottom. I see that hand. Are you getting charismatic on me or what?
Yeah, no.
What?
If you don't have a bank, I think there's some.
Oh, yes, good point. There are banks in the lobby, you know, so if.
Isaac will be up there.
Yeah, Isaac will be there. If you don't know Isaac, look for a kid holding knees. Then say, hi, you must be Isaac. And he'll give you a bank, all right? So, yeah, if you need one, thanks, Karen. I was going to mention that, and, you know, something happened in between when I thought of it or when I was told that now. So, anyway, Bible study at Golgi's tonight. If you have questions, right? Okay. If you have questions on that, you can see John or Jackie or Isaac, the guy with the banks. He knows about it, too. It's at his house, so you can do that. Ladies Bible study with Cheryl. Leading is rolling, and they are meeting this week as well. If you have questions on any of those, see them. If you have other questions or thoughts on anything in the bulletin or not in the bulletin, let us know, and we'll do what we can to help answer those for you. Turn to Micah chapter 3. We're going to start reading Micah chapter 3 here in a little bit, and you can follow along.
Unjust leaders judged. Then I said, now listen, leaders of Jacob, you rulers of the house of Israel, aren't you supposed to know what is just? You hate good and love evil. You tear off people's skins and strip their flesh from their bones. You eat the flesh of my people after you strip their skin from them and break their bones. You chop them up like flesh for the cooking pot, like meat in a cauldron. Then they will cry out to the Lord, but he will not answer them. He will hide his face from them at the time because of the crimes they have committed.
False prophets judged. This is what the Lord says concerning the prophets who lead my people astray, who proclaim peace when they have food to sink their teeth into, but declare war against the one who puts nothing in their mouths. Therefore, it will be night for you without visions. It will grow dark for you without divination. The sun will set on these prophets, and the daylight will turn black over them. Then the seers will be ashamed, and the diviners disappointed. They will all cover their mouths, because there will be no answer from God. As for me, however, I am filled with power by the Spirit of the Lord, with justice and courage, to proclaim to Jacob his rebellion, and to Israel his sin.
Zion's destruction. Listen to this, leaders of the house of Jacob, you rulers of the house of Israel, who abhor justice and pervert everything that is right, who build Zion with bloodshed and Jerusalem with injustice. Her leaders issue rulings for a bribe, her priests teach for payment, and her prophets practice divination for money. Yet they lean on the Lord, saying, isn't the Lord among us? No disaster will overtake us. Therefore, because of you, Zion will be plowed like a field, Jerusalem will become ruins, and the hill of the Temple Mount will be a thicket.
The Lord's rule from restored Zion. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's house will be established at the top of the mountains and will be raised above the hills. Peoples will stream to it, and many nations will come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us all about his ways, so he may walk in his paths. For instruction will go out from Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem.
He will settle disputes among many peoples, and provide arbitration for strong nations that are far away. They will beat their swords into plows, and their spears into pruning knives. Nation will not take up the sword against nation, and they will never again train for war, but each man will sit under his grapevine and under his fig tree with no one to frighten him. For the mouth of the Lord of hosts has promised this. Though all the peoples each walk in the name of their gods, we will walk in the name of Yahweh, our God, forever and ever.
On that day, this is the Lord's declaration, I will assemble the lame and gather the scattered, those I have injured. I will make the lame into a remnant, those far removed into a strong nation. Then the Lord will rule over them in Mount Zion from this time on and forever.
Amen. Well, we should sing the dates of Elijah. That might sound appropriate. Let's stand together, please.
Righteousness leading to soul.
We were singing that, and I was thinking that the line in there that kings will surrender their crowns, and they will. Some out of their own desire, but some because they will be forced to. Forced to because of the majesty of God, because of who He is, because when He comes, and He comes to rule, and He will be the ruling king, and they will not have that spot anymore. And I was thinking, we have the opportunity to give now, to give from some of what we have, and we have that opportunity to give now to honor God. We have that opportunity to give now to recognize Him as King in our lives, and really even in this world, even though again some of them don't realize it. But we who do realize it have that opportunity to honor Him through the offering. As the ushers come forward to receive your gifts and offerings, let's pray again. Lord, we sing those songs and we all bow down. It's not just a physical thing, it is that internal bowing down as well. That we recognize you as Lord. The offering is a part of that. It's a part of the way we recognize you as Lord. As we give this, it's because we do know that all we have comes from your hand. We do know that you are God, you are in control. All that we have should be used according to your will and your way. We pray for the direction, certainly, of our church leaders and the other organizations and missionaries we help support through these offerings, that they would be led by you. But we think, too, of what we keep. Don't ever let us think that we're done once we give an offering and that the rest is ours to use as we please. Help us to use it as you please, we pray, in Christ's name, amen. That's good, Isaac. Guys, throw me a little bit of a clap for the video. Go ahead, start the kids one, turn the rest of these off, I'll get out of the way.
It doesn't matter how smart you are, you don't know everything. Hey guys, it's me again, Douglas, and I don't know about you, but sometimes I have a hard time following instructions. You know, I don't always want to do things exactly the way I'm told to do them, and sometimes I don't even like to look at the instructions at all. Like, you know, if I get some Legos or something, I like to build what's on the box, but I try to build it without looking at the instructions, see if I can do it, you know, kind of like a puzzle or something. Or if, you know, pretty much anything, I try to not follow the instructions if I can. You know, if the teacher says you gotta do this, I do that thing. But if I can get away with it, I usually try to do things my own way. And that might work out sometimes, but it is definitely a better idea to follow the instructions. And man, if we're talking about instructions from God, yeah, you should follow that every single time. But yeah, there was some time where my friend, he was gonna have this gigantic, epic water fight. So he invited all the kids from all over the neighborhood, and we were gonna have this giant, big party, and everybody was supposed to bring their water guns, and his mom sent out a list to all the families, you know, of things that they were supposed to bring, you know, stuff that we were supposed to bring to this big old water fight. And, you know, I kind of looked at the list, and the list said, bring all these things, but I was like, eh, I don't really need to bring all those things, right? And so, yeah, like the water gun, I brought my water gun, and I brought my swim trunks and everything like that, but on the list was goggles. And I was like, I don't really need goggles, because, you know, it's just a water fight. We're just going to be squirting each other with these water guns. And if the water gets in your eyes, it's not that big a deal. And I knew they were going to have a slip and slide and stuff, too. And I was like, I'll just close my eyes on the slip and slide. So we get to this party, and, oh, man, it was so much fun. We were, you know, squirting each other, and we were going on this big old slip and slide. And he had this, you know, this, like, inflatable pool thing that he brought out. And it was this big, fun party this summer. And it was so much fun. But one of the things that they did at this party, at this big old water fight, was they got a whole bunch of cans of shaving cream, right? And so it was a big old shaving cream fight, too. So it's the water guns and the shaving cream. It's this huge, big mess, and it's super fun. And so I'm running around with the water gun, and I'm spraying my friends, and they're spraying me, and you know, we get the shaving cream, and we're splattering it on each other, and everything was really fun and really fine until one of my friends, he snuck up behind me, and he yells, "Snake attack!" And he goes, "Pfft," and splatters my face with a big old blob of shaving cream. And it got right up in my face and in my ungoggled eyes. You know, I'm a pretty good sport. If somebody gets me the shaving cream, you know, it's all in good fun. But the second that shaving cream touched my eyes, I was just like, ah! Oh, because it hurt so bad. My eyes were burning. It felt like my eyes were on fire. And so I'm like running around and I can't see because they burn so bad. And I'm trying to, you know, like get the stuff off of my face. And I'm running around and I can kind of just barely see. And I finally go and I find the pool. And I just take my hand and I go dunk, 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 dunk down into the water. And my eyes were like so red and they hurt so bad. And everybody was just like staring at me because everybody's, you know, having fun. But then all of a sudden I'm just screaming like a crazy person. And, you know, in the instructions for the party, they said bring goggles. But I didn't realize that, you know, we were going to have a shaving cream fight. Or I didn't also realize that shaving cream hurts your eyes so bad. If I had known that, I definitely would have brought the goggles. But that's kind of beyond the point, right? They knew that shaving cream burns your eyes, and they said, bring goggles. And so instead of just trying to do my own thing, trying to go my own way, I should have trusted them. They told me to bring goggles because they knew what would happen. So I should have obeyed. I should have followed those instructions. And I feel like that happens with us and God all the time. You know, God gives us these instructions, and we're like, yeah, I'll follow the instructions that make sense to me. But if I don't totally get the whole reason for following the instructions, I'm not going to follow them. That's a bad idea. Because God sees stuff that we don't. God sees the much bigger picture. And so if he tells you to do something, you should do it. Don't just pick and choose the stuff that makes sense to you. If God says do it, do it. If God says don't do it, don't do it. Because God sees the bigger picture. God knows everything that's going on. And so if he gives instructions, it's from the perspective of someone who knows everything. And our parents and our teachers, they're not God, but they also have a bigger perspective than we do. If our parents tell us to do something, we should do it. Because they've got a bigger perspective. They know more than we do, like it or not. And so that's my challenge to you guys today, is that you would follow the instructions, that you would obey God and your parents and your teachers and really anybody who gives you instructions, and you would follow those instructions. Because even if you're super smart or super clever or whatever, you still don't know everything. And when people give us instructions, especially when God gives us instructions, it's not for us to pick and choose which ones we like and which ones we don't like, which ones we think are important and which ones we think aren't important. It's our job to obey. And if you follow God's instructions to the letter, you know, not just picking and choosing the ones that you like and don't like, but just faithfully following God and obeying his instructions, I promise that your life will go much, much better. Because if God knows everything, which he does, it is a very, very good idea to follow his instructions.
You know, you can go ahead, children, up through first grade, dismiss for children's church, go downstairs at this point with their helpers and their people that lead them down there. That is Zach and Hannah's son. Which one? Jude. Hannah's right next to him, but she got cut out of the picture because she's not a kid. So, okay, you have to put that somewhere so that this clicker works. I don't remember where it is or what you got to do, but that or I have to go beep every time. I can go forward, but I can't go backward. And he set it up some other way. Get Scott, find Scott again, make him do it. Anyway, all those fun details. Don't you like it? This summer, I went bike riding with several of my grandchildren in our neighborhood. Peter and I did, and at times it was a little bit like herding cats and, you know, trying to get all the fruit flies in a jar. It didn't quite work out real well. We didn't go very fast. We didn't get very far. We covered a lot broadly, just not lengthwise. We didn't get very far at all with that. I spent a lot of my time making sure that they were following and helping them to learn how to follow as we went bike riding. We the range of ages there, so some of them were pretty good. They were curious, though, all of them. Their attention was diverted by other things while we rode, and I had to gently remind them many times, you know, that they needed to follow. I had to remind them which side of the road that they should be on, you know, the same side as me, basically. And I had to remind some of them to use their brakes instead of dragging their feet, you know, as we went along. And, to look further down the road as we're riding to help them go straighter and not fall off the edge of the sidewalk. Older ones who had been writing longer still needed every once in a while to be reminded that they needed to follow, you know, that they weren't always sure where we were going, if they were out ahead and they might be turning the wrong way. I certainly didn't want them getting lost. I also didn't want anyone getting hit by a car, and I didn't want them hurting anyone else, you know, as they crashed into each other and things. I wanted them to learn, I still want them to learn the importance of following well, of what it means to follow well. Now, as you may have guessed, I'm not talking about bike riding today, but we are looking at the importance of following well. Let's pray, and we're going to get into our passage. Father, thank you that, that you at least got my attention long enough to help me and to understand that I need to follow. I don't always do it as well as I should, but I also thank you for giving me some who are worthy of following to help me find you. That's so important. And Lord, now you still called us to follow. Even those of us who might be in a leadership position, you've called us to follow and to follow you. Teach us from your word as we look into it to see how we might more be, again, not only the people you've called us to be, but those who can help others come to know you and come grow more to be the people that you want them to be. So guide our time, our thoughts as we look into this. Bring our attention back when our mind wanders. But most of all, put our attention on you, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen. We're going to be, it's not wherever it needs to be. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. This is a continuation of God's answer to Solomon's prayer at the dedication of the temple. The answer did not come at the dedication. If you look through, you know, the whole chapter here and stuff, you'll see there was a feast day. It was followed by a seven-day festival. Then the dedication lasted another 7 days. After all this, you see in verse 10, it tells us that Solomon sent the people home. You know, he sent them this 15 days of service and worship at the temple was coming to a close, and he sent them all home. And then in verse 12, we're told that God came to Solomon to answer the prayer that Solomon had prayed at the dedication back there. Now, we've been looking at the answer to the prayer for 5 weeks. This is our last week in 2 Chronicles chapter 7. Next week, I plan to move on into the epistle of 1 John. Now, that's not the gospel. It's not the Gospel of John, it's the epistle. Or just get to Revelation and back up a little bit, and you'll be at 1 John there. But pray about that, because I really want it to be God's direction, not my ideas, not my thoughts. And if he changes it somewhere else, I want to be able to understand that. So, be praying about that. Now, if you recall here in 2 Chronicles, the book of Chronicles, 1st and 2nd Chronicles were one book to begin with. It was separated to make it easier for people that, you know, that division isn't necessarily, inspired. It isn't necessarily, it's not on the same level as Scripture itself. But if you look at the end of the book of Chronicles, you will see there in chapter 36, verses 22, 23, it ends there with the decree of Cyrus allowing the nation of Israel to return to the land to rebuild Jerusalem and to rebuild the temple. That is the setting for the entire book of Chronicles, 1st and 2nd Chronicles. That's the setting where they were allowed to go back to rebuild the temple. So as they're heading back then, God directs, you know, the chronicler to record these things. They were a conquered people. They were exiled. As they're reading this, they were a conquered, exiled people. They were removed from their land for generations. And now they had been taken captive. When they were conquered, then they were exiled to Babylon. And then here, you know, 1st and 2nd Chronicles is the writing of their history to give those returning exiles hope, to give them insight as to how to live better as God's people, how to better live in a relationship with God is what he's writing to them about. They didn't want to repeat, they wanted to rebuild. They didn't want to end up again in exile and a conquered people there. So how to understand, they needed to know how to understand, what brought them into captivity, why, so they could avoid that, so they could avoid, that same problem again going forward. Now, they get to the point where, King David is the ruler, and he's followed by his son Solomon. I think David was probably the high point, David and then going into Solomon, but it was really, it runs very quickly downhill. During Solomon's reign is when this thing, the wheels are wobbling, and they're wobbling like crazy. We had a friend, we always used to joke that we were going to drive our cars till the wheels fell off. They were going down Interstate 94 in Chicago. If you know where Hubbard's Cave is, it's as you're downtown, you're in the downtown part where all the exits, and they're going off to the left and the right, and then you enter this tunnel. Just before they entered this tunnel, the wheel flew off of their Ford Granada, wing, and the wheel was ahead of them entering the tunnel. So what was happening here? It's during Solomon's reign. Those wheels are wobbling. They are wobbling, and they're coming. It's going crazy. And here in the last half of chapter 7, I want us to see what happened, because really what happens is the wheels fly off when Solomon's done. I think it's in chapter 10 when, in chapter 10, the wheels are gone. The wheels are flying off of the cart because Solomon's son was a knucklehead. Anyway, so here in the last half of chapter 7, I simply want to share with you some thoughts that God impressed upon me as I read the verses of this chapter, keeping in mind the downfall of the nation that was experienced soon after this chapter. Now, we're going to look at it in three smaller sections. For context, I'm going to start in verse 12, where it tells us that the Lord answered the prayer. So follow along. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, beginning in verse 12, it says, "Then the Lord appeared to Solomon at night and said to him, 'I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a temple of sacrifice. If I close the sky so there is no rain, or if I command the grasshopper to consume the land, or if I send pestilence on my people, and my people who are called by my name humble themselves, pray, and seek my face and turn from their evil ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. My eyes will now be open and my ears attentive to prayer from this place. And I have now chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will be there at all times.'" Now we're gonna pause there for a minute. We've already covered through verse 14 in previous weeks, so we're really starting in verse 15 today as we're looking at some of it. Something that becomes clear right away, I think, as we're looking at this, is God is attentive. He is attentive to his people. When God's people seek him, they will respond. Here's the thing that we need to get. Know that God is not avoiding you. He is not avoiding you. God is not making it difficult. He is not making it difficult for you to know him. God is not giving you the silent treatment. And if as husband and wife, or as brothers and sisters, or as parents and children, even with neighbors, if you're giving somebody the silent treatment, quit it. For pity's sake, quit your pouting. Suck it up. Put on your, I was going to say your big boy pants, but I don't want to offend you. Get over it. Get over yourself, this silent treatment. God is not giving anyone a silent treatment. God wants you to know him. Look at John chapter 10, verse 14. "I am the good shepherd. I know my own sheep, and they know me." God wants us to know him. John chapter 14. "If you know me, you will also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." A little later in John 14, "He is the Spirit of truth. The world is unable to receive him because it does not see him or know him. But you do know him because he remains with you and will be in you. First John chapter 2, this is now how we are sure that we have come to know him. We have come to know him by keeping his commands. Chapter 5 of 1 John. And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true. In his Son, Jesus Christ, he is the true God and eternal life. God is not avoiding you. He is not avoiding you at all. He wants you to know him. He also wants you to understand his word. John chapter 16. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you. He will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own, but he will speak whatever he hears. He will also declare to you what is to come. God wants you to understand his word. 2 Timothy chapter 2 says, consider what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. The Lord will give you understanding. In James, he tells us, you know, in James, at the first chapter, you lack wisdom. He says, any of you lack wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without criticizing, and it will be given to him. God wants you to know him. God wants you to know his word. He wants you to understand his word and his truth. God, you know, tells us that his ear will be attentive to our prayer. As we're looking at 2 Chronicles, his ear will be attentive to the prayer. You know, the assumption is there that you're actually praying, you see. That's the assumption there. The assumption is that you make time to pray. Now, you know, it is good to have a place to pray and a time to meet with God. It is good to do that. Somewhere where you can concentrate on God, somewhere where you can block out all of the things that interfere and all of the things that distract you. For me, it's first thing in the morning in our living room. If I wait, I'm distracted by all sorts of things. It doesn't take much to distract me, you know, but it's so what part of that means. Part of that means then is that I get up early enough to have the time I need to spend with God. I have to get up early enough to do that. You know, now, maybe morning isn't your thing. Here's the deal, though. Don't use that as an excuse and then never get to it during the day. When I was doing millwright work, when I first became a Christian, and then I grew to learn to that I needed to, you know, spend more time with God and his word, I started, that, what I did for a while is I did it during lunch at work. And in fact, another guy and I for a while, you know, we had a Bible study together. He was a new Christian, had just come to the Lord. He was working where we were, and so I was trying to help him grow, you know, disciple him a little bit, and so we met together for a Bible study during lunch. And that worked out fine then, you see. But that doesn't work fine for me now. It just doesn't. So don't use the excuse that I'm not a morning person. I can't get up early to do this because I'm not a morning person, and then never get to it. If you're never getting to it, quit lying to yourself and start making the time. You know, you have that time, and you have a place for reading the Bible and for praying. You will not find the time. You need to understand that. You will not find the time. You have to intentionally set time aside. Intentionally, on purpose, making a choice. Just like you do for going to work. You know, I'm just assuming that some of you would probably rather do something else sometimes instead of going to work. But you go to work, or you go to school. Or you do all these other things that you need to do, and that you have to get in, and that you have to make a time. Set an appointment with God. You know, do it. Set that time aside. Now, there is a time when I used to be able to do this at Panera Bread in the morning, and I tell you, I really did like that for a while. I could go there. The first time I tried it, I went to Panera, and I was amazed at how much I was able to get done, how much it worked for me. I could shut out the noise, and I could really connect with God. But then I noticed myself starting to pay attention to some of the distractions. What was going on around me really hadn't changed. It was the same stuff, you know. It was the same stuff. You know, that really hadn't changed. What had changed was now I was starting to give my attention to those distractions. So that had to come to an end, and I changed it, and now I do it at home, and it works really much better. I mean, there's a consistency there. God is not avoiding you, so you quit avoiding him. Just a thought for you. Let's go on. Verse 17, follow along. It says, as for you, if you walk before me as your father David walked, doing everything I have commanded you, and if you keep my statutes and ordinances, I will establish your royal throne as I promised your father David. You will never fail to have a man ruling in Israel. Now, this is the promise was made to David about never failing to have a man ruling in Israel. The promise was made to David. God is simply pointing it out to Solomon, you see. He is simply pointing that out to Solomon. It's not a new promise, you know. It's the same promise that he made to David. Here he's just pointing it out to Solomon. These are some specific promises here as he's addressing Solomon personally, you know, that if Solomon continues to pursue God, if he continues to live with God as number one in his life, that God would, you know, keep his family on the throne. Instead, Solomon strayed widely. You know, and you know, he wasn't following God like he should. He wasn't following God wholeheartedly. I really even doubt that he was following God half-heartedly. He was just really, this wise man foolishly began to rely on his own wisdom instead of God. He began to rely on his own wisdom instead of God, and he pursued pleasure and his own desires. Now, be a thinking person. I'm not saying not to use your mind. Use your mind, apply your intellect, but don't ignore God. You know, use your mind and your intellect, but don't ignore God. I think the more you use your intellect, the more you have to work on your relationship with God. Otherwise, we begin to trust our reasoning more than we trust God. When the two are in conflict, when your reasoning, you know, or trust are in conflict, you know, trust God. Trust God at those times. Your intellect, be honest with yourself, your intellect and your reasoning have been wrong before. God has never been wrong. God has never been wrong. When your intellect or your reason are in conflict with God, then what you need to do is trust God. After Solomon died, the kingdom, it fractured, the wheels came off. His son Rehoboam followed Solomon as king. Rehoboam chose to increase the practices of his father Solomon. There's a little picture of how far Solomon had gotten. He got to a point where he was abusing and really forcing his own people. You know, and Rehoboam follows the advice of his knucklehead buddies instead of the more wise advisors. And the result was that 10 out of the 12 tribes, out of the 12 tribes of Israel, 10 of them left and weren't under Rehoboam anymore. They chose another king. Now the promise here in 2 Chronicles was pretty clear that if Solomon followed God, then God would respond favorably. Israel's only chance was if Solomon here had followed God well. That was Israel's only chance at this point, that Solomon would follow God well and teach his son to follow God well. But he didn't. He didn't do either one. He didn't do either one of those. One of the clear lessons here is if you want your children to follow God well, then you follow God well. If you want your children to follow God well, then you follow him well. Solomon messed up, and he didn't follow God well. Big surprise, Rehoboam didn't follow God well. In fact, we could probably stop with didn't follow God. You don't simply tell your children how to live. You do that. You do that. Don't think that you could just live before them. Tell your children, you know, how to live well. But you also need to live that commitment to Christ that you want them to have. One of the, I think, most unthinking statements I hear people make sometimes is that, I'm not going to force religion on my kid. I'm going to let them choose for themselves. So what you're doing is you are living out the example to them that it is that God is not important. What do you think they're going to follow? Now, some of them, sure, will come to know Christ, but a lot of the people out there who don't know God, you know, it's because their parents just, God never entered the picture. You know, to say that, you're going to grow up and let them choose. Do you do the same thing with their diet? Do you do the same thing with their schooling? Do you do the same thing with their driving? Do you do the same thing you want your children to follow God well, then you better be following God well. You are replaceable everywhere but home. You quit your job, guess what? They're going to get somebody else to do it. I don't care if you're the president of some company. You lose your job, they're going to get somebody else to do it. Probably before the week is over. I don't want to hurt your feelings, I just want you to understand that. But you are not replaceable at home. You know, I grew up without a dad. You know, most of you know that. I grew up without a dad at home. They're really, now my mom didn't remarry or anything, and I'm not saying anything that step parents aren't good. You know, some are wonderful. You know, Jenny had step parents. Her parents were divorced. Jenny was adopted, and even after her mom died, her adopted father, you know, kept her, and that was the home, the household there. The only grandchildren our children have left living right now is Jenny's stepmom, you know, and she's a wonderful lady. So I'm not saying that they can't be there, but you can't abandon home and think that somebody else is going to step in and replace you. That's not, that's just, you know, some of us here have a strong faith because your parents taught you about God. Your parents taught you about God, and they lived out that strong commitment to God as well. You know, but some of us here are first generation followers of God. But for both, if you want to see a strong commitment to God in your children, then teach them both with your words and your example what it means to have a relationship with God. Follow God well. Part of Solomon's claim to fame, I don't know if it's a claim to fame, but part of his claim to fame is that he was the last leader over a unified Israel. He was the very last leader over a unified Israel, and it all went downhill very steadily, you know, after the example left by the choices he made. Solomon had a lot of wisdom, he had a lot of knowledge, but he started to use that knowledge to serve himself instead of God. He wrote a lot of wise sayings, you know, a lot of proverbs are written by Solomon, but the example of his self-centered living won the day with his son, so that his son chose to do ungodly things. Don't be the last generation that follows Christ in your family. Don't be that. Teach your children about God and his love for them, then follow God wholeheartedly yourself. Teach them, and then follow God wholeheartedly yourself. One of Solomon's proverbs that he didn't live out very well, chapter 22, verse 6, teach a youth about the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. You see, Solomon knew better. Solomon didn't do better. He knew better, but he didn't do better. You know, the inconsistent way that he lived actually turned into the evil way that he lived. And that example won the day in Rehoboam's life to the destruction of Rehoboam and the destruction of the nation of Israel. Look at verse 17. For he says, as for you, here he's talking to Solomon as an individual. As for you, if you walk before me as your father David walked, doing everything I commanded you, if you keep my statutes, Others, you know, others could be an example, and we can learn from them. I can learn from them. But it is my personal walk with God that matters. He says, if you, he's talking to Solomon as an individual, you, Solomon, if you as an individual walk before me, as your father did, you need to take it up. You need to take up the reins, he said. Others can be an example, but it is my personal walk with God that matters. That walk, the word walk there that he used, it's, you know, to conduct yourselves, to live your life, you know, to follow God wholeheartedly. He calls us to that. I can be inspired by others, I can get ideas from others, but the goal is not to be like others, the goal is to be more like Jesus Christ. That's the goal. Philippians chapter 2, make your own attitude that of Christ Jesus. Paul is writing and he says, make your attitude that of Christ Jesus. He's told others, you know, in other places, he said, follow me as I follow Christ. There's the example, that of Christ Jesus. Make your own attitude. Your actions are going to flow from your attitude. What's on the inside is what comes out. Make that, set your heart. How do you do that? By prayer, by studying his word. How do you do that? By setting a time aside intentionally, purposefully making time for God in your life. That sounds ludicrous, you know, that we would do. It's ludicrous that you don't do it. 1 John chapter 4, it says, in this, love is perfected with us so that we may have confidence in the day of judgment, for we are as he is in this world. In this world, he wants us to live. Your goal is not to help your children be like you. Your goal is to help them to be more like Jesus. Adopting his values, emulating his character, his love for others. Follow God well and teach your children to follow God well as also. Verse 19, pick up with me, verse 19 in your Bible. It says, however, if you turn away and abandon my statutes and my commands that I have set before you, and if you go and serve other gods and worship them, then I will uproot Israel from the soil that I gave them, and this temple that I have sanctified for my name. I will banish them from my presence. Remember who's reading this. The guys who are reading this are the ones who are going back to fix a temple that was destroyed. He says, I will make it an object of scorn and ridicule among all the peoples. Verse 21, as for this temple which is exalted, everyone who passes by will be appalled and will say, why did the Lord do this to the land and to this temple? Then they will say, because they abandoned the Lord God of their ancestors who brought them out of the land of Egypt. They clung to other gods and worshipped and served them. Because of this, he brought all this ruin on them. God will not help you walk away from him. Some of you probably already filled that blank in. God will not help you walk away from him. He says, if you turn away and abandon my statutes and my commands. The you here is plural. Here, the you, back in verse 17, it was singular, where he was talking specifically to Solomon and telling Solomon, right on point here. You know, Solomon, giving Solomon, it was really a warning to Solomon, and it was a warning that Solomon didn't think he needed, you know, but it's a warning Solomon didn't heed. But here, you know, here in verse 19, it's a plural. He's speaking to the nation. He's speaking to all of those. He's speaking to all of, about his people, to all of those who have a relationship with him. Just as he was back in verse 14, if my people, he's talking about my people, those who have a relationship with him, all of those who have a relationship with him, he's saying, and instead of turning from their evil, wicked ways, as it says in verse 14, they chose instead to turn away from God. You need to realize it's either one or the other. There is no such thing as sitting on the fence. Don't buy that lie. There is no such thing as sitting on the fence. There are no gray areas. We use that as an excuse when we want to do something that we're not really sure we should be doing. We say, well, it's really a gray area. No, it's not. There is no gray area in Scripture. A gray area simply is an area that you need to get more light on, because God's not confused. God is not confused about what he wants for you in any circumstance, in any situation. He is not wondering which way you should go. He is not thinking, well, maybe this one will be okay this time. That is not, God knows. So if you think you are in a gray area, quit using that as an excuse to indulge yourself and instead seek after God, and he will very clearly show you the way you should do. A lot of times when we say it's a gray area, it's because we already know what we should do. We just don't want to do it. Your choices and actions are either for God or against God. That's it. Those are your only two choices. You are for God or you are against God. Mark chapter 9. You know, they said, hey, there's these guys casting demons out in your name. We want to stop them. And Jesus said, hey, don't stop them, because whoever's not against us is for us. What he's saying is there's only two choices here, boys. There's only two choices. Look at verse 19 in 2 Chronicles, verse 19. If you turn away and abandon my statutes and my commands that I have set before you, and if you go and serve other gods and worship them. You serve other gods when you put anything ahead of God in your decision making. You serve other gods when you put anything ahead of God in your living. When you do those things, you are serving other gods. And so instead of God healing their land here, they had to be uprooted, they had to be removed, because they were making a mockery out of following God. They were not living as God's people. You know, they did not follow well. They didn't follow God well. They followed sin, unfortunately, well. And to allow them to continue taking action, you know, that if God allowed them to continue on in sin as God's people, you know, they're the nation that's called God's people, and as if as God's people, he allows them to, you know, continue, God would be supporting a lion. He won't do that. He will not do that. Don't ever expect God to help you sin. God will never lead you contrary to his word. He will never lead you contrary to his character. He never lead you contrary to his attributes or his being. He won't do that. And if you take that time to pray, if you set that time aside to pray and read his word and study his word, then you will know his character. You will know his being. You will know his will. You will understand who he is. The more you know and understand God, the more and his word, the more you will understand his will. God does not abandon his people. His people abandon him. When they choose sin over God, when they choose not to follow well. Don't be the last one in your family to follow God. Make sure you personally follow God well. Follow him well. Set a good example. But also, you know, teach your children, your grandchildren, your nieces, your nephews, whatever children you have the opportunity to pour into. Maybe it's a neighbor kid. I told you before, you know, I have a neighbor kid who is open enough to me that allows me into his life a bit. And, you know, whatever opportunities you have, you know, pour into their lives. Teach them about God. Teach them to follow God well by your words and by your example. Follow God well. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for those who helped me to learn the importance of this. Help me to keep it as an important factor in my life. For all of us together here, I pray that you would help us to be people who would follow you well, intentionally, on purpose, with purpose. Don't ever let us choose our own ideas over your word and over your truth. Don't ever let us lie to say that it's a gray area. Don't ever let us lie to say that you've abandoned us. Don't ever let us lie saying that you are silent. Thank you for your word, which speaks to us and continues to speak to us. I know there's been times in my life, Lord, where my mind has been just a little cloudy and a little messed up, and it took me a while to sometimes brush the junk away. But you continue to love, you continue to reach out, you continue to speak through your word and through your people. Help us to follow well, to follow you well in all things, I pray, in Christ's name. Amen. Would you stand together for the benediction, please? And if you need prayer for anything, Roy, I'm wondering if I could tap on you one last Sunday here to come up and pray. Pastor Roy will be heading back to Florida this week, but he'll be up here to pray with you if you need prayer for anything. And as we dismiss, you feel free to come forward. Pastor Roy will be up here. We have other elders, deacons, deaconesses. They'll keep their eyes open for you, and I'll be happy to pray with you for you. Maybe it's been a struggle with you following God, or maybe you've been distracted because there's other stuff going on, other challenges, and you want someone to pray with you. As we dismiss you, come on up front, and I'll pray with you and for you. And now unto him who's able to keep us from falling, and to set us before his presence without fault and with great joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and dominion, both now and forevermore. And all God's people said, amen. I feel like I was yelling a little bit today. That certainly wasn't my intent, but it's important.